I would like to thank everybody for coming tonight. And before we begin tonight's proceeding, I would like to acknowledge that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Ngunnawal peoples and pay respect to the elders past and present. I recognize and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs, and relationship with the land. I also extend respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people here today. So we're about to begin the film screening, but before we do, I would like to introduce our special guest, Gu Tao. Gu Tao was born in 1970 in Inner Mongolia, China, where his father was an ethnographer and a photographer. He graduated in 1995 from Inner Mongolia Art College with a major in oil painting. After studying photography at the China Academy of Art in Beijing, he started making documentary films, many of which have won awards at international film festivals. The movie we will see today, The Last Moose, is the third of his Aoluguya trilogy, and Aoluguya refers to the place where the film is made, which includes Aoluguya, Hugo and his mother, and then this film today. So after we are done with the movie, we will have a panel discussion and a Q&A with the director. So thank you so much for coming, and I hope you enjoy the movie.
His research focuses on issues of environmental pollution and grassroots actions in Mongolia, China, and Japan. Next to him is Professor Lee Narangoa, who specializes in modern Japanese and Mongolian history, culture, and politics. Before she joined the ANU as the ANU staff, she was a researcher at the Nordic Institute of Asian Studies in Copenhagen. She teaches courses in Japanese history and language, Mongolian history, and other courses including lies, conspiracy, and propaganda. Dr. Christian Sorace is a postdoctoral fellow at the CIW, and his research focuses on ideology, discourse, and political concepts of the Chinese Communist Party and how they shape policies, strategies, and governance habits. And of course, Gu Tao, who is the director of the film. What we're going to do is the three panelists will respond to the film first with short statements, then Gu Tao will speak, and I expect that soon after that we'll open up to questions from the audience. So why don't we begin with Wuqi, would you like to begin?
Good evening, everyone. So I'm an ethnic Mongolian from Inner Mongolia, so it's my great pleasure to be here and share my feelings with all of you and the director, Gu Tao. It was 2 years ago, one of my high school classmates recommended this documentary to me. He's an ethnic Daur. Daur people is also lived very close to Ewenki people in the northern part of Inner Mongolia. He said that you should watch this documentary as a social scientist. He told me that he had lots of stuff to say about this documentary, but just don't know where to start because he had a kind of mixed emotions. And then I found this documentary on YouTube. Eventually, I got the same feelings too, a kind of a mixed emotions. So the Wuqirilitu is very familiar to me. I even imagine that I met him somewhere in my Mongolian community. In other words, I understand his feeling and have a great sympathy of his life. There is a sense of loss in our hearts in terms of language, culture, living environment, life, and dignity. Because of that, I would say Wuqirilitu is the kind of model of our generation. He's not only belonging to Ewenki people, but also belonging to ethnic Mongolian people too. I think one of my friends from Daur people had the same feelings. Of course, on the other hand, many ethnic Ewenki people and of course the Mongolian people have made a different choice. As Weja said, just drink yourself to death. The rest has to adopt the new environment. So there is a choice to be the rest. In a sense, I'm the one should be considered as the rest. We don't drink too much. We're trying to keep a sober mind and we're feeling kind of compliance for our ability to adapt. That is why we have mixed emotions toward Weja. Weja's words are so sharp and he makes us not very comfortable. His words pierced our wound where it had not yet healed. So finally, I'd like to express my admiration for Guthao's independent view of history. Forward and progress has an unshakable position in Chinese political atmosphere. In a perspective of progressivism, Weijia is a kind of backward person, and his fate is eliminated by history. However, Guthao has issued a different point of view, which created an opportunity for us to stop and rethink. Thank you, Guthao, and thank you, everyone.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Narangoa, and I watched this film only by recommendation by Christian, and so. When I watched it, it made me think a lot of things. And many of my reflections are very similar to what Wuqi has already mentioned. So I'm also an ethnic Mongolian from China. And so there are a lot of similarities. So when I saw this film, I thought my first impression was saying, well, this is not a Ewenki story, it is a story he represents the many minorities in China and many minority intellectuals, how they feel about their own culture, their situation, and about their ethnic future. So it is a very sad story, but the interesting thing is not only the Ewenki and many other minorities, they have this kind of incredible sadness about their own future, and at the same time they have incredible they are incredibly proud about their own past, and they believe that modernity and progress is not something that we can measure with high rises, with technology. There's every single civilization has got their own progressiveness and own value. So, the other thing I was thinking about or reflecting about this film. Was that the kind of questions many of you may also ask is that is there any way we can preserve, we can coexist without actually being assimilated, without losing kind of own language and culture? So it made me and. Compared to Ewenki, Mongols are sort of the bigger minorities, and they still have their own language and their own script. And so many intellectuals compared to the Ewenks. But I think it is not the number which makes difference. I think, what makes difference is whether we recognize each other, whether it's a very small number of people or very small language, whether it has got script or not, whether how we could preserve it. So there are many other thoughts I had, but I'm very happy to discuss with you.
So first, I would like to thank Gutau so much for making the long trip to Australia and for making these wonderful films. So this is one film that belongs to a series, and I definitely recommend the other ones. And all of which have given me many intense emotions and opportunities for reflection. I would also like to thank the ANU Center on China and the World and our director, Dr. Benjamin Penny, for hosting the event. And especially I would like to thank Nancy Cho for all of her hard work and ingenuity in dealing with the logistics. I would also like to thank the Mongolia Institute and Dr. Li Narangoa for their sponsorship. And there are so many people I would like to thank who helped me in different ways, but then we would be here for a while. Which actually leads me to my point. It's funny when planning an event, you realize how dependent we are on infrastructures of support and on other people. And a part of what I want to talk about tonight is what happens when those infrastructures collapse and are taken away. I think one of the reasons why Gutau's movies are so haunting is that their message travels and resonates beyond their local circumstances. We can even learn about the Ewenki's contemporary predicament by looking across the ocean at the history of genocide and sedentarization of Native American nations in the United States. And it is even more interesting if we track the history of animals. The disappearance of the moose from the forests of Hulu and Be'ar and the eradication of the bison from the Dakota Plains were central to the processes of cultural extinction in both places. In her book, Dispatches from Dystopia, the historian Kate Brown argues, quote, "The story of General Custer and his defeat by Crazy Horse at the Battle of Little Bighorn is well known. So too are his infamous trips through the plains, shooting bison, and leaving the stench of rotting flesh. Custer was one of a number of Americans who felt that the extermination of the buffalo would inspire the Indians to settle down," end quote. For pastoral nations like the Sioux, the Cheyenne, and the Crow, the end of the buffalo meant the end of their way of life. In the haunting words of Plenty Coup, the leader of the Crow Nation at the end of the 19th century, quote, "When the buffalo went away and the hearts of my people fell to the ground and they could not lift them up again, after this nothing happened," end quote. So more than a century later and on a different continent, we hear Weijia say, quote, "The guns were gone after we moved. We had nothing to do, so we started drinking. Drinking heavily, people started dying. Already eight of us have died. We're lost, our culture, our guns are gone, so we drink," end quote. In his book, Radical Hope, the philosopher Jonathan Lear interprets Plenty Coup's statement to mean that life for the Crow went on after the buffalo died, but there was no longer a world in which actions could be ascribed familiar meanings. As Lear explains, the same action that meant one thing in the past, a display of martial valor and courage, meant an entirely different thing on the reservation. It was now illegal and a barbaric practice. The only bridge between these two worlds is one of memory and loss. Similarly, for the Ewenki people, life continues in the settlements, and Weijia's life continued when he moved to Hainan, but it is life without a world. So why is the fate of nomadic reindeer people in the remote regions of Inner Mongolia so haunting? When we watch Weijia's self-destruction on the screen, we see people that we know, including our own future possibilities. I've heard before that Gutau rejects the label of being an anthropological filmmaker, I suspect in part because Weijia's situation of living amidst cultural collapse belongs to the human condition. No one expects that their world will disappear. The possibility that the world can collapse is probably the kind of knowledge that Nietzsche suggested we must forget in order to remain alive. Weijia, when he is living in China's southern island of Hainan, he remarks, "I'm not interested in the sights here, the big hotels, that has nothing to do with me. I'm just interested in the local villages, their customs and way of life." Perhaps his motivation to research other villages was driven by a shared sensibility of camaraderie through the experience of loss and precarity. Perhaps he wanted to find other possibilities for coping with extinction. Yeah, thank you.
Now we'll ask Gutau to speak, perhaps responding or saying other things about the film.
谢谢这个大学和 Christian 来做的工作，让我能带一个很冷的片子来到这么温暖的一个国家。
Thank you so much to the ANU and to Christian for allowing me to bring such a cold film to such a warm place.
当然，这种温暖还包括一个国家的一个制度。
And the warmth is not just of the weather, but it is of this, the system that we have here in Australia.
对于电影，我也不知道去说什么，但是，在十年前，促使我能拍这个电影，一个系列电影的是，我看到的现实和我在的那个现实里和我。看到的电视上的这个现实不一样。
10 years ago when I began to make this film, I saw that the reality before my eyes was different from the reality that I saw on the TV.
但是我每次在和大家一起看的时候，我也总觉得还没拍好。
Whenever I see this film with a group of people, I always feel like I haven't directed it well enough. I haven't made it well enough.
因为我在这个十多年拍摄的过程中，也没想到会在电影节上放，也没想到会在大学的这样的一个标准的空间里放映。
Because when I was making it, it never occurred to me that I would be showing it at film festivals or universities in such a, you know, in a very regular theater like this. It hadn't occurred to me.
但在后来的时候就感觉，技术本身也不重要了，甚至用的设备也不重要了，是实实在在的去表现了我对欧文克。在这个拍摄过程中的一个最直接的一个观察。
But it for me, it's the important thing is not the technology. It's not that stuff. What it is to actually honestly reflect what I was my observations of the Ewenki people. Can I ask a question? I don't know. It's very, very interesting. So you spent 10 years living with the Ewenki people. How did they react to your presence when you were with them? I mean, they seem very natural with it at this point, but how did you gain the confidence of the people who's you know, you were filming?
我说你十年在那儿。一直拍，你刚开始的时候呢，你怎么会让他们对你放心，对你那么信任，让你去拍他们的生活？
因为我父亲在七十年代末八十年代初就用照相机和文字在记录鄂温克族，还有鄂伦春族。北方的达斡尔族的，在七十年代末和八十年代初的那种生活。
My father had been documenting the lives of the Ewenki people and several other minorities from that region in photographs at the end of the 70s and the beginning of the 80s.
我的父亲他也不像其他职业的摄影家。一样的拍照，它是带有一种在生活里，完全是这种观察式的记录，所以小的时候，我十几岁的时候跟他洗照片，我看到了那个世界很美丽，所以这个是到我自己开始，观察的时候，就三十年后的这种巨大的变化的一个，让我开始有做纪录片的。
When I was young, when I was 10, 11, 12, I would see my father who would just go into their lives and observe them and photograph them like this. And when I was a young boy, I would see him developing these photographs, and I thought, this is so beautiful. This is such a beautiful place and people that he's documenting. And so I wanted to see 30 years later what had happened, what it was like.
这三十年其实正是中国从八十年代的改革开放的一个三十年，有很巨大的一个变化，但是同时也有一种最沉重的失去的无法再能保护下来的，比那个发展更重要的东西。就是这个民族的精神和民族的生存，最传统的生存方式。
Those 30 years, by coincidence, were also the 30 years when the reforms, the first 30 years of the economic reforms, during which China experienced a lot of economic growth and progress. But what I saw there was heavier than the progress was the loss of culture, the fact that this culture that was so unprotected, a loss of traditional spirit and tradition in general.
最初我是从美学、美术学的一种角度去的这个地方，就是因为我是学美术的。在森林里有一个还是一个很有特点的一个民族在森林里生活，但是在慢慢的拍摄过程中，就各种问题是影响了我的那种观察，影响了我的一个态度，所以就形成了这样的一个片子。
I come from an arts background. I studied art at university, and so when I went to start filming, what I was actually ended up filming was not what I thought I would be filming. A lot of things that I encountered along the way influenced the way that the film came out in the end. I'm wondering whether anyone, yes.
I have a question about their language. So this speaks Chinese in such a fluent way, and I think most of the herders, the Mongolian herders, ethnic Inner Mongolian herders living in a rural area, they can't speak Chinese like Weijia, and Weijia even can make a poem in Chinese. I think, in a sense, Weijia Chinese may be much better than mine, even though I'm living in a city in Hukat. So are they only speak Chinese in daily life, or I thought they also speak Ewenki language, all right? So is that because of you filming them, they always speak Chinese, or are they speak Ewenki with their Ewenki community members?
Weijia 还有他的族人，其实，在70年代、80年代就已经都讲很流利的汉语，而且
他们讲什么？
就是汉语，中国的那个普通话，就他们不会因为对方需要什么，他去为你去准备什么，所以我。也经常有人问我是不是，或者你要求他们说汉语好能够你听得懂，但是不是的，就他们已经是完全在用汉语交流了，但是他们的老人是即使懂汉语也会说汉语，但是他们拒绝说汉语。
Actually, Wei Jia and his clan have been speaking Chinese since the 70s or 80s. A lot of people ask me this question. In fact, these Wei Jia and his clan and the people that you see, they do speak Chinese among each other. It's the older people who can speak fluent Ewenki, and they often can speak and understand Chinese, but they refuse to.
So how did you choose Wuqirilitu? Because he's an incredible character, no? He is really intelligent, and what is his education level?
And how did you choose?
Yeah, how did you?
Actually, when I went there in 2004, I began filming lots of different families. But I worked with them. I drank with them. I slept in the community. I was there for a long time. But I did live in Wei Jia's and his family's tent. They were a bit looser, a bit freer. He painted. I painted. It made sense. There are two other films in this particular series, and Wei Jia doesn't make that much of an appearance in the other two.
而且这个片子剪出来之后，我也发现魏佳的表达是非常好，在平时拍的时候也没有太多的感觉。 没为了做一个片子去拍这个片子，只是用很多素材，最后剪出的时候，它的变化又是最丰富的，有离开森林，又去了海南，又回到这个森林，就是变化很大的，是剪片子剪出来之后才觉得是。
Also, when I was editing the footage, that's when I kind of discovered Wei Jia as someone to become the center of the film. It hadn't occurred to me really before when I was just filming him and everybody else. But the changes in his life were the most dramatic. The biggest changes, occurred to him. He went to Hainan. The love story, the end of the love story is returned to the forest and so on. So it was through the process of looking at all the footage and editing that I made this particular film about Wei Jia. Okay, I think we have about 15 minutes for questions, and we have microphones, so if you raise your hand, I'll send the microphone round to you.
So should I ask in English?
I think ask in English and then Chinese if you can do both.
Okay.
That's great.
So I want to appreciate Gu Tao Daoyan first, because I think this is really an amazing movie, and I really enjoyed it a lot. And like I uh, So I cried twice. The first time is like when Weijia mentioned that the Ewenki people, they just follow the like the schedule of the nature, when the animals they're mating, you can't just hunt or just kill them. I think it's very important because nowadays just people just don't really obey it anymore because they want to like make more money. And the second time is just at last because he seemed like very he seemed that he got no way to do because he lost his culture and he couldn't do what he used to do anymore. And the whole the whole
do you have a question?
Oh yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Just so that everybody has a chance. So no statements, questions,
yeah, sorry,
please.
So my question is, just because I think this movie got some parts which is kind of maybe it's not allowed to play in China. So I just want to ask like how it is like in China, because I also noticed it's kind of different from what we read from the news in China, like what the minority life are like.
Okay,
and how is Weijia's life now?
Okay, could you ask that in Chinese? Or do you want me to?
Okay.
你好，就是我真的特别喜欢这个电影，然后我就是想问一下，现在就是这个维嘉的近况怎么样？这个好像，然后还有就是现在这个鄂温克民族的这些孩子，他们还会去讲自己的语言吗？然后他们是就是怎么会去跟这个大城市接轨，还是他们更愿意待在就是自己的栖息地这样？然后还有就是这个片子现在在国内的近况怎么样？就是国内是允许它上映吗？因为我也注意到了这个跟就是新闻里边报道的少数民族的近况非常不一样。谢谢您。
维嘉在从海南回到森林之后，又开始喝酒，当然喝酒他也在画画写诗。今年八月份的时候呢，他是又一次喝醉了，他就觉得生活已经没有意思了，没有意义了。他拿了一把猎刀就去了那个森林里。因为这个片子里之前几年前拍的是他说很多人都自杀了，像日本人一样，所以今年八月份他自己就用这种方式自杀了，但是没死了，就在医院住了几个月的住院了三个月吧，现在刚刚恢复，又回在山上。
After Weijia returned, he began drinking again, and you know, he was drinking and writing his poetry and painting, but he was drinking a lot. And in August, he got very, very drunk, and he decided that life was meaningless. The people who he'd referred to before who had all taken their own lives, and the way that they'd taken their lives was a kind of like a Japanese using a knife to disembowel yourself. So he took a knife and he went into the hospital and he tried to commit suicide. This was last August. But he survived and he was in hospital for several months and now he's back home.
特别平静的从容的去把自己的肚子划开之后，他就等着，太阳落山。他说太阳落山了，他还没死；月亮又上山了，他还没死。他就感觉特别冷，他就回营地了。回营地被别人看到之后，送到医院。
He very calmly cut himself and waited for the sunset and.Figure that he would be dead, but he didn't die. He got very, very cold, and he somehow made his way back to the settlement, and they got him to a hospital.
现在恢复了，因为当时医生说，如果他不是一直在森林里生活的话，他的命就没有了。
And, you know, he's now kind of recovered. The doctor said he really has to live in the forest. Otherwise, there's nothing for him.
其他的年轻人呢，也都在城市里读书。读书，他的父母也希望他们留在城市。所以语言，过去还有学校，现在这个鄂温克语的学校，小朋友们他们能上的五年级，但是在十年前也就没有这个学校了，都跟汉族一样的去读书读汉语，所以仅仅是身份证上的一个保留的一个民族的这个一个民族吧。
Other young people study in Chinese schools. If they're in the settlement, the parents prefer them to stay in the settlements to study there for their future. 10 years ago, they closed down the last Ewenki, the schools where people learned in Ewenki, and now for the young people, their status as an Ewenki or other minority is basically just a matter of their what's written on their ID card.
这个片子呢，因为我们在中国，被叫成这个独立纪录片、mm-hmm. 独立导演，所以跟那个官方的这个，那个。放映的机制不一样，就是也没有通过审查，我们就会拍，所以也不会在公共的这个电影院去放映或者电视台，也这是没有通过审查的。
I'm an independent documentary maker, and so I'm outside the official system. There's no you know, I don't submit my things and have them passed. I don't get public showings in cinemas or on the television. That's how it works.
So thanks, thank you very much, Director Gutau, for bringing such an impressive film here. So my question is, like during your making this film, and also like after that, is there any like governmental or non-governmental organization, they're taking measures to preserve like the heritage, like the cultural heritage or other like features of those like minor ethnic groups like in China. 所以就是谢谢您把这么棒的一部电影带过来，然后我们今天能看到。我的问题呢，就是说在您拍电影的过程当中，还有包括后续的一些时间里边，就是中国有没有就是政府部门或者说其他非政府机构，这些公益机构，然后说来做一些事情，能够帮助这些像鄂温克族这种少数民族，然后来保持他们的一种文化的一个传承呢 ？Thank you。
对这个我还真知的，就是还好像真没有，因为据我在这个八年的这个时间里，其实有很多人都在上山去猎奇式的，去也拍片子啊，也写文章啊，但是还没有具体像那种 NGO 吧，就类似这样的组织，这个出现。要做一些具体的事，
没有 NG，
没有，就是，好像是，对呀，应该没有。但是中国有很多学者，关于民族问题的学者呀，还有一些人类学者呀，他们，也会有开会呀，去研究，研究一些问题，能够，但是没有解决的办法。
No. In over the 8 years that I was there, you'd see lots of people coming to the hunting areas, very curious. They were looking, you know, at the Ewenki as exotic. But no NGOs came to help do anything like that. There's lots of scholars in China, ethnographers and anthropologists and so on, and they discuss this and they try to figure out how to preserve these cultures, but nobody's come up with a solution. So that's where it stands.
谢谢顾导，我想问的一个问题是关于喝酒的。就是说在这个片子里面我看到，就是说可能平常很多人对少数民族或者是当地的民族存在着一种偏见，认为他们落后是因为他们喝酒太多了。那您在这个刚才您也说到，您其实去到那个地方也跟他们一块儿喝酒，而且很多民族本来他们就有喝酒喜欢喝酒这样的一种偏性。所以我想问问您，就您的观察来说，关于他们怎么样喝酒的一个更全面的一个现象到底是什么样的。So what I want to ask is about alcohol drinking in this film. Maybe some people think Aboriginal people are backward because they drink too much, but actually you mentioned you also drank with them, and perhaps drinking is also part of their culture. So could you provide us a more rounded viewpoint about their drinking culture? Thank you.
因为在鄂温克族还有鄂伦春族，在更早的时候，他们也在喝酒，但是喝酒，和现在完全不一样吧，情绪不一样吧，我感觉，这过去是因为猎获到一个猎物，大家来分享猎物，那么酒也是一个分享的方式，那时候可能有极个别的人可能会喝醉酗酒。但是现在从这个2003年，生态移民之后，交了猎枪之后，和过去的生活完全不一样了，就是生活没有意义了，生活无望，进入一种无望的生活了，所以就普遍的开始酗酒了，就这个变化挺明显的。
There was drinking before, but it was very different. The spirit in which alcohol was consumed was very different. What would happen would be if they, for example, in the hunting, they would, kill an animal and everybody would enjoy it together and have a drink to, as part of that, that sharing. It was a way of enjoying things together. But after 2003, with the settlements, the taking away of the guns, and so on, there was a loss of meaning and a loss of hope in people's lives. And that led to the kind of drinking to get drunk, this sort of nihilistic drinking that we see in the film.
Yeah, we just mentioned that approaches who make the moose disappear. Who those approaches, he indicated, are they Han people? 就是维嘉在店里，维嘉说有那个偷猎者造成这个那个 moose 的 Han 的消失。他说这个偷猎者到底是谁啊？是汉人吗？因为他们本身是猎人呢。那到底这偷猎者又是谁啊？
偷猎者是警察和这个北方的还有一些下岗的工人吧，就是因为在北方还有林场的工人，他们其实生活也不是很好，也只能上山去利用森林的资源去下套啊，下那个野兽的那个套子啊什么这都是汉族人吧，
是为了吃肉吗？或者是
他们是为了买
买什么呢？
买为了那个卖这个猎物，
是买这个吗？或者是买皮，或者
皮呀、啊、什么
肉
啊？
police and some of the northern the migrant workers in the north They're Chinese. They work by setting traps, and they don't do very well. They're poor. And I asked, why do they poach? What's the point? And the reason is to sell the reindeer to sell the horns, the meat, the skin, the whole thing. So, yeah, those are the poachers.
非常感谢顾导演带来这么棒的作品，然后给我们看。然后我觉得确实是这个传统和现代的发展是一个永恒的话题，很难去 balance。那么，就是我有几个问题。第一个问题就是维嘉以前学过画画没有？
让别人问。
Okay, so I will ask just two short questions. Can I?
Ask one because we've got two people.
Okay, sure. So, I'll ask one question.So I know that you shoot this film for a long time, for eight years. So at the very beginning, do you know how long will you shoot? Because the stories will always be continued. So how do you know that when the story will be end and then you start making this film and then present to the audience? 就是说您一开始在拍这个电影的时候就已经拍了一开始您可能不知道要拍多久，然后那您拍了八年的时间，那其实故事一直都在继续。那您怎么能够决定，就说这个故事，我打算在这个时候就把它给做结束，然后呈现给观众呢？
就是你看的这个片子的结尾啊，就是，但是今天没放出来最后一个镜头，应该有三秒钟吧，就是维嘉从海南回到了森林，他念诗和他扛一个木头。这个木头最后扔在地上了，这个，但这个卡住了。当时是，就是我当时剪辑的时候，我就觉得这个片子应该结束了，就是什么东西都能放下，不管有是在进入什么样的一个生活状态吧。就否则一个片子，其实人的一生都在有变化，但是对于我。个体的一个作者，面对的再少的少数民族，他们也是一个群体，就这个片子，我是这么样的就结束。
With this particular film, there was a thing which we didn't see because the DVD got stuck. It was just a 3-second thing, and what it was when he's carrying that log through the forest.And what he does is he throws it down. And it seems to me that, yeah, you can throw things down. Life has so many changes. That's where in the editing process I decided the film could stop. I think, yeah, we've got two questions there, and then we might have to conclude. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.首先我觉得导演你这部片特别棒，但是我再美的话我就不说了，我就直接问问题了。我的问题是关于一个文化保存和文化变化的这么一个矛盾的问题。我觉得维嘉他们的语言和文化在消失，是因为外界一些政策的影响受到了一个更加政治上更加强势的文化的冲击，但是我好像又觉得如果我们让文化和语言就让他们自然状态下发展的，他们在互相交流中也是会发生变化的，可能会变得互相学习，然后会变得越来越相似，会自己原有的一些东西会消失。然后我们好像一方面在强调要保存一个文化原有的样子，一方面又在经常鼓励年轻人去做文化交流，去互相学习。我不知道您怎么看这个矛盾。我要我再自己翻译一下。
Yes, just briefly.
I'm asking a question about the contradiction I felt between the culture preservation and cultural change, because I feel like Wei Jia's loss of the language and culture is due to the pressure from the policy.Or some political reasons, but I feel that if we let the culture and language go naturally, they will also change and learn from each other, and sometimes they will become more similar due to cultural communication. And
Yeah, I feel like it seems on the one hand we're encouraged, we want to keep a culture the way it used to be, and on the other hand we encourage people to make cultural communication and learn from each other, and I wonder what you think of this contradiction. Thank you very much.
我们做的这样的电影在中国也是小众电影，独立电影，像你说的那样的电影中国很多呀，这种民族的励志的片子其实有很多的，我不知道你可能也没注意看呢，或者是因为今天看这个电影想到这个事情，就每个人都有自己的一个表达吧。就比如说我在这个地方的时候，是我的一种观察。我也没希望，我也希望看到有其他的人对这个地方的一个表述，一种观察。但事实上也很多，电视台呀，也有电影，在这个展现一个民族在定居之后他们怎么样融入到这个文明社会啊，现代社会啊，但可能那个不是我观察到的，所以因为我也不是一个这个人类学家呀、民族学家呀，我只是一个用我的一个感觉一种本能的东西，可能是跟人的那种最自然的人的这种情绪有关系的这个态度，去记录了一段这样的历史吧。这可能也不是最后，但是只是这我在那个一段时间所能观察到的吧。
I'm an independent filmmaker, and this is the story I tell, but there are lots of films that do tell a story along the lines you were describing. Everybody has their own way of experiencing a thing, and these are my observations. There are lots of films and TV shows that show that kind of assimilation and that kind of, I suppose, the happier story. I'm not an anthropologist, I'm not an ethnographer, I'm just using my personal reaction to what I saw in this one little slice of history. It's one part, it's not a whole, it's just a piece of the story.
Thank you very much for your film, I really enjoyed it. And I just want to know whether it's had a lasting impact on you yourself. Like the main character was more interested in still seeing the village rather than the big city. Has it had that sort of impact on you?
I didn't quite catch it. Did you?
Has it had an impact on you?
Oh, the story?
Yeah,
the story. Oh, okay.
Okay. 这个故事怎么样影响了你？怎么样？就是这
样。现在我的拍摄工作已经从北方大兴安岭又向中国的西北，是新疆的北方去进行拍摄，就是让我有一个一种比较和一种新的一个观察吧。想在新疆的北方看个哈萨克族，还有在新疆的南疆的蒙古族巴音布鲁克那边是这个民族和在这个时代的状态，生存状态和精神状态。
然后
我发现在中国的民族都面临同样的问题吧。
In addition to this, I've gone to the northwest, to Xinjiang, and looked at, for a new perspective, to compare how different minorities in China have coped, I suppose. I've looked at the Kazakhs, the Mongolians who live in south, in the southern part of Xinjiang. And what I've seen is that there's a lot of similarities in all of these stories.
Before we conclude tonight, I would also like to thank Linda Jaivin for doing such a fantastic job translating. Everybody for coming and taking time out of their busy schedules to come see this film, and again to thank Wutok for being here and for doing it again. I kept thinking myself if Wutok didn't go with his camera to record this, you know, it would be an even greater tragedy. Because it would just disappear without a trace.
这个悲惨的故事更悲惨，因为没有人记录下来。
So anyway, thank you all. Please check out our website. We have other films coming up in March and other events at the Mongolia Institute as well. And again, I appreciate the support and have a wonderful evening.